الحمد لله، الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا في ملء السماوات وملء الأرض وملء ما بينهما وملء ما شئت من شيء بعد. أهل الثناء والمجد حق ما قال العبد وكلنا لك عبد. ثم الصلاة والسلام على الرحمة المهدى والنعمة المسدى محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه وذرياته وأهل بيته ومن تبعهم بإحسان وسلك طريقهم إلى يوم الدين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ولقد وصينا الذين أوتوا الكتاب من قبلكم وإياكم أن اتقوا الله. ثم ما بعد، قال الله تعالى: الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات طوبى لهم وحسن مآب. Allah Jalla Fi'ula says in this verse of the Quran, those who have believed and their hearts find tuma'nina, a key word, and their hearts find tuma'nina, calm, peace, tranquility, serenity, settlement and rest and stability in and with the remembrance of Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Indeed, with the remembrance of Allah and in the remembrance of Allah do hearts find طُمَأْنِينَ, this calm, this peace, this tranquility, settlement, stability and rest. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, those who have believed and perform righteous deeds. طُوبَى لَهُمْ, goodness is for them. وَحُسْنُ مَآبٍ, and a beautiful return, meaning to Allah. Moreover, Allah says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى هُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيَنُّ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Whomsoever performs righteous deeds, be they man or woman, whilst being a believer, then we shall most definitely give them a good life. And this should not be misunderstood. وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ, and we shall most definitely reward them according to the best of what they used to do. Allah says in part of the verse, فَمِنْهُمْ شَقِيٌّ وَسَعِيدٌ, related to the Akhirah. Of them there will be those who are shaqi, miserable and sad and wretched, and those who are sa'id, happy, blissful, joyous, rejoicing. And there are many other such verses that talk about this topic, which I'll, inshallah, build on. This topic concerns all of us. In fact, it's relevant to men, women, old, young, Muslims, non-Muslims. Relevant to us all. Thousands of books have been written on this topic. Modules in universities teach this. The United Nations has dedicated a day and called it after this. The topic is happiness. And one can use a few words. This is probably even misleading to use the word happiness. And this is the same topic I touched upon on Eid Day only 2 weeks ago. What is it? What's it made out of? Does it really exist? In what form? Where can it come from? Is there true happiness or is it just deceptive? Or should we be looking for something else? in the form of tuma'nina? Is that more achievable? Is that more attainable? Is that more sustainable than just this happiness and bliss that we've been sold? Have we been sold a lie, which is your aim and objective is to achieve happiness in this world? And not only that, not only are we told the aim and objective and the purpose and the goal is to achieve happiness and bliss and pleasure in this world, but we'll tell you how to achieve it too, through the latest cars and the latest iPhone and having a fat bank balance. Have we been sold a lie? Alhamdulillah, we know what our purpose is, our ultimate purpose, our fundamental goal. It's mentioned time and again in the Quran. Allah spells it out. Perhaps the clearest verse in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created the jinn or mankind except that they worship me. And there are so many other verses. And the purpose of worship, to attain taqwa, as Allah mentioned in another verse. And the purpose of taqwa is so that we are loved by Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهِ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah loves those who are muttaqi and have taqwa. Can we call achieving and seeking happiness a goal, an objective? That would be very problematic to call it a goal. As Muslims, happiness, and I mentioned this on Eid Day, there's no contradiction here. For instance, Allah says, Allah mentions, فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. Let them rejoice in this, meaning the Quran, Islam, Allah's bounty and mercy. And the Messenger saying, لِلصَّالِمِ فَرْحَتَانِ يَفْرَحَهُمَا. For the fasting person, there are two occasions of happiness. Hinting that this is something which is fickle and whimsical, volatile and elusive. Something which is passing and fleeting and momentary. It's not something which is the standard default position that we are blissful and happy all the time. That's unattainable. It's unsustainable. We're chasing ghosts and phantoms. We're chasing something that can't be caught. We are worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal, trying to achieve taqwa and thus earning the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as an offshoot, as a byproduct, as a result of this ibadah, we will feel tuma'nina. That's what Allah says. أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Those who have believed, the base and foundation is rock solid, there's iman. What's iman? There's a connection, a relationship, a rock solid one, a robust one, a strong one between yourself and Allah. And then there's the dhikr of Allah through salah, siyam, zakah, umrah, tasbih. And then a person finds what? Happiness. And perhaps when we see this as a translation in some books, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, those who have believed and their hearts find happiness. This is perhaps an incorrect translation, because a person's there praying salah, nawafil, making dua, dhikr of Allah, and he or she says, I don't feel happy. I do all of this. I don't feel bliss and joy and jubilation. Because that's not what Allah is saying. We are worshipping Allah, that's the aim and objective, to worship Him, achieve taqwa and earn Allah's love. And as a byproduct, we feel not so much happiness. This thing is fleeting. It's elusive, it's fickle, it's short-lived. In this world, happiness is deficient. So, we worship Allah, and as a byproduct, there's tuma'nina. Relaxation, settlement. A person feels at ease.
not so much bliss. True happiness is in the Akhirah. In the dunya, it's deficient. It's incomplete. It's unsustainable. And there's no contradiction. When the Messenger says things like, أَرْبَعُ مِنَ السَّعَادَةِ, four things are of happiness, a spacious house, a nice ride. These things of the dunya, a nice phone, a nice house, a pious wife, pious husband, nice food, etc. These things supplement and complement and add to. They're not the source of. Our happiness, albeit incomplete and deficient in the dunya, and our tuma'nina doesn't stem from here. Because like I said on Eid Day, if it does, we will be very, very disappointed. Very. If you're going to pin and peg your happiness on somebody, anybody, family, friends, colleagues, associates, if you're going to make your happiness, and not the complete happiness, obviously, that deficient one of the dunya, or even your contentment and peace of mind, if you're going to make that contingent and dependent on any human being, her, him, them, or any worldly possession, your car, house, bank balance, these things are very flimsy. Here today, gone tomorrow. People flip in a blink of an eye. We should be striving to build our connection with Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is my final point. How do we achieve the short-lived happiness of the dunya? And what's more sustainable, the tuma'nina, the calm, the peace, the settlement, the rest of the heart, the tranquility of the heart, more sustainable, more attainable, through our relationship and connection with Allah. There's no other way. Films won't do it, movies won't do it, games won't do it, chocolates won't do it, shopping for clothes won't do it, your friends won't do it, looking beautiful and pretty so people can gaze at you and stare at you won't do it. It has to come through the relationship between you and Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They have not appreciated Allah and understood Him the way they ought to. Do we know Allah? Everything else is predicated on this ma'rifah. There is no concept of hubbullah, loving Allah, muhabbatullah, or at-tawakkul ala Allah, or ar-raja, hoping in Allah, or makhafatullah, fearing Allah. These concepts in Islam, they mean nothing without ma'rifatullah, knowing who He is first. The Messenger says, لَيْسَ الْغِنَى عَنْ كَثْرَةِ الْعَرَضِ إِنَّمَا الْغِنَى غِنَى النَّفْسِ. Richness, true richness and wealth is not the abundance of عَرَض, worldly possessions. إِنَّمَا الْغِنَى, غِنَى, true richness and wealth is غِنَى النَّفْسِ, the richness and the wealth of the soul. And shurah al-hadith, the commentators of hadith have mentioned, this is through one's alaqah, one's sila bi rabbih, one's connection and relationship, one's link and bond with their Lord, Allah Azza wa Jal. The Messenger says, the Messenger said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal when he sent him to Yemen, إِنَّكَ سَتَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ. You will go to Yemen and see a people of the book. فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ. Let it be that the first thing you call them to is شَهَادَةُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. There is no God worthy of worship except Allah. And I am the Messenger of Allah. فَإِذَا عَرَفُ اللَّهِ. Then when they know Allah, then أَخْبِرْهُمْ. Tell them about salah and zakah and so on. There has to be ma'rifah. There has to be knowledge of Allah. The connection and link needs to be there first. Malik ibn Dinar, one of the Salaf, he says, Masakeen ahl al-dunya. How masakeen? Masakeen here means, how unfortunate are the people of the dunya. Kharaju min al-dunya wa lam yadhuqu atyab ma fiha. They have left the dunya having not tasted the most beautiful thing in the dunya. So they asked him, what's the most beautiful thing in the dunya? And he said, ma'rifatullah, knowing Allah. Forgive me for this very crude and simple, mundane example and analogy, but it helps. Imagine you're in your house and there's a mob and a gang outside wanting to attack you. The first scenario, you remember somebody. This somebody is fearless and strong and brave, and he has a gang. And every member of that gang is brave and strong and fearless. Now you remembering this person, obviously there's a connection and a relationship and a strong one between you and him. You know him, he knows you, and therefore remembering this person, picking up the phone and ringing this person will give some kind of comfort and solace to your heart that he will come. Inshallah, he will come and help me because I know him, he knows me, there's a strong connection. So you remember him and you feel at peace. You ring him, he comes with his boys, job done. The other scenario is they're outside, this mob and gang. Now, if you don't know this person, or the connection and link between you and him is very weak, then how will remembering this person bring you any comfort and solace and reassurance and relief? It won't. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثْلُ الْأَعْلَى. To Allah belongs the better example. When we are sitting doing subhanallah, alhamdulillah, or praying salah, or doing umrah, or hajj, or reading Quran, or doing our nawafil, fasting Ramadan, and so on, if the very connection between us and Allah is non-existent or there but very weak, how is our tasbihah, our saying subhanallah, alhamdulillah, going to mean anything to us? If anything, we just get more and more bored because the foundation's not there. Very similar to Ramadan. We heard this verse so often in Ramadan. You can split this verse into three parts. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. O believers, iman, connection between you and Allah Azza wa Jal, and a strong one. Then do the act of worship, which is siyam, and then inshallah you will see the fruits, which is taqwa. But if we are stumbling at the first hurdle, if we are flopping and fizzling out at the beginning, this is problematic. This is what Allah stresses again, iman. There's no meaningless repetition here. Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, aminu billahi wa rasulihi wal kitab. O believers, believe. But you've just believed. What do you mean, believe? What does that mean? Is this a meaningless repetition? No, it's not. O believers, truly believe. The A'rab, the Bedouins came and said, as Allah quotes, قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. The Bedouins, the nomads, the A'rab have said, we have believed, آمنا. Say to them, O Messenger of Allah, قل لم تؤمنوا. Say to them, you haven't believed. ولكن قولوا أسلمنا. Rather say, we have apparently submitted with your tongues. I'm a Muslim, I'm a mu'min. And true iman has yet to penetrate your hearts. We should be working on our iman day and night. Not if we have 5 minutes to spare. Once that's strong, then our ibadat, with concentration, with focus, with devotion, with understanding and comprehension, Allahu Akbar. The doors of wilayah and being a wali of Allah are not shut. The doors of being a wali of Allah are not shut in this day and age. It's not like it was open for the people before us. Iman, understanding, and inshallah we will achieve at least the incomplete, deficient happiness of the dunya and contentment, and the complete and absolute happiness of the Akhirah. As Allah says, أدخلوا الجنة, I'll end with this verse, أدخلوا الجنة أنتم وأزواجكم تحبرون. Enter therein, you and your partners and your spouses, تحبرون, rejoicing. But this rejoicing is everlasting, complete. As the Messenger says in one hadith, that a caller will call out in Jannah, Ya Ahl al-Jannah, inna lakum an tan'amu wa la tab'asu abadan. O people of Jannah, you will be happy therein and you will never ever experience sadness and grief ever again. I pray Allah grant us the tawfiq to understand. Naqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiru innahu huwal ghafur. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. إن الله أمركم بأمر بدأ فيه بنفسه ثم ثن بملائكته المسبحة ثم ثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون فقال إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وسلم تسليما. اللهم اجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماعا مرحوما واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تبقي فينا ولا منا ولا حولنا احدا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الحياة منهم والاموات. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها انت خير من زكاها انت وليها ومولاها. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك واغننا بفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا آمنا بما أنزلت واتبعنا الرسول فاكتبنا مع الشاهدين. ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. وصلى الله تعالى على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وأقم الصلاة.